sugar.
Dorothy Summers, Joe Summers, who takes care of all of our technology, she lives down in Connecticut, and she sent me that little video, and I thought, I'm going to use that. I mean, that video raises a really great question, doesn't it? What's going on inside of you? I mean, if you were to listen to your heart, what is the song that would be playing? Would it be the Hallelujah Chorus or something far less flattering? That's a good question. What is going inside of our hearts? The world around us, if we allow it, can unduly influence our hearts, right? I mean, there are the problems of this world, the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and you know, just the temptations that we face, pleasures of this life. They all have a way to somehow or another cause our heart to mimic the beat of a very different drummer. And if we're not careful, the results can be pretty devastating. You see, because the heart, it affects the way we look out on life, doesn't it? The heart, it helps us to frame how we view the future or the way we look at trials and temptations that come our way. The heart reveals what it is that we value the most. Jesus says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And the heart was really created to sing. I remember years ago sitting in a service, and there was this one song that it's always stuck with me. It's an old hymn. It says, I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. I never heard a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody of love. What's next? That's right. There rings a melody of love. Great song. Yeah, they're great. Thank you very much. You guys are signed up for the choir. The words, they portray something that's going on inside a person's heart, right? But the melodies sometimes need a little work. I mean, I don't know about you, but if you've ever been to one of those skating rinks, sometimes those tunes, they could be in your head and you half expect the light to go on and say, couple skate, you know, in my heart there rings. Right. But there is a song that Jesus gave us. The recent studies that we've been looking at in the life of Timothy shows that he's begun to lose perhaps the song that Jesus gave him. There's fear, there's embarrassment, there's all of that mixed with uncertainty, and it's all challenging Timothy's faith. Not to mention the disparate voices of the culture that have begun to obscure not only his calling, but it began to diminish his love for God. And so Paul sought to revitalize Timothy's resolve by beginning to confront him, by reminding him of his new identity in Christ, of reminding him again of Jesus' promise of grace and of life and of immortality to all those who would endure to the end. You see, the constant negative environment was beginning to wear Timothy down. So Paul cheers Timothy on, providing him with some important next steps. In particular, how to respond to the quarreling, to the godless chatter, to the false teaching that was beginning to surround him. And so this text that we're going to look at today is Paul's way of helping Timothy to respond to that environment. And I think that it has some really good words for us today. The question is listed in your sermon notes, but the question here is, how are we then to respond to the opposing views we encounter in the world? Because we've already established, not only in Timothy's day, but in ours, and especially living where we are, there is this sense of hostility, right, towards spiritual things. It's not an everyday conversation that people have to talk about their relationship with Jesus. In fact, to bring it up, it almost feels really awkward. Why is that? There's nothing awkward about Jesus. But the environment around us, it kind of puts that social pressure where you kind of feel that way. And yet, we live in a culture right now pretty free to express our opinions, right? So how then are you supposed to live out this Christian faith in the midst of that kind of environment where there's so many opposing views? How is that not then to affect you in a negative way? Well, that's what Paul is trying to relate to Timothy. So I want you to look at 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 14 through 19. It says, "Keep reminding them of these things. Warn them before God against quarreling about words. It is of no value and only ruins those who listen. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a workman who does not need to be ashamed and who correctly handles the word of truth. Avoid godless chatter because those who indulge in it will become more and more ungodly. Their teaching will spread like gangrene. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, who have wandered away from the truth. They say that the resurrection has already taken place, and they destroy the faith of some. Nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm, sealed with this inscription, 'The Lord knows those who are his, and everyone who confesses the name of the Lord must turn away from wickedness.'" So now, one of the first steps in responding to the opposing views we encounter in this world is to follow the advice that Paul leads up to here in verse 15 of your text. And that is to pursue God's calling on your life. The way that you are to deal with the dissonance in our culture is not to try to blend in, but it's to stand out. It's to pursue the calling that God has on us as those who have named the name of Jesus. That's why he says here, do your best. In fact, that the strength of that word is it's a forceful command. It's an imperative. It's saying, come on, you know, get with the program. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a workman who does not need to be ashamed, who handles correctly the word of truth. You see, the word approved there is an interesting word because the word there is usually applied to precious metals like gold or silver that are tried by fire and then purified. So it's saying that as workmen, we are now called to be tried and true. That the way in which we handle the trials that come our way has everything to do with formulating character. And character, if it has its way, will produce in us a maturity. And that maturity, Jesus tells us through through James, that it will cause us to be complete, not lacking anything. So now this work of God in our life as this tried and true worker, there's something else here. It says that we ought not to be ashamed. The worker here ought to be confident in the way in which he is, putting forth his efforts. Nothing to be ashamed of, nothing to be embarrassed about. We're out there, we're doing what God is asking us to do, confident as we begin to just follow his will and his ways. Timothy is counseled not to be ashamed to testify about Jesus or about Paul's chains. God's word is not chained. He's encouraged to fulfill his duties and to live above reproach, free from the criticism of others. But there's something else here, right? It says that they have to correctly handle the word of God. The idea here is on being correct. It's on being, true, on cutting a straight path. In fact, the very word speaks of something that talks about cutting straight, as in a path. You might remember this text from Proverbs chapter 3 in the Greek translation of the Old Testament. We find in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, there is this text here. It says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight." You see that path straight? That's the same word here that says handle correctly. It's cutting a straight path for your life. It's taking this word of God and using it to begin to show that the worker is a faithful worker. This worker, it says, is faithful then to the word of God in his life. And so one of the ways to deal with the culture around us is to put on this mindset. What is it that God has called us to be? And what is it that God has called us to do? But to be a worker who is tried and true, confident in the way in which he is putting forth his efforts, and one who is faithful to this word of God. And when you start thinking about those implications, how does that then begin to impact your daily life? Do you know what God's will is for you? And I'm not talking about this grand picture of like, oh, this is my heavenly calling. I'm talking about everyday kind of responsibilities. The way you parent, the way you are a spouse, the way you're a friend, the way in which you engage your work, the way in which you spend your money or your free time. Are you confident before God that have nothing to be ashamed of? Because see, if I am not going to begin to blend into the culture around me, if I'm going to be able to withstand all this opposition, then I have to be strong on the inside. Inside of me, I have to be pursuing God's call on my life, tried and true. But that's only one step, because the next part here brings us to the beginning of our passage where it says, keep reminding them of these things. Warn them before God against quarreling about words. See, if I'm going to be a good workman, part of my responsibility here is about reminding and reminding people of these things. In other words, it's saying, do your part. I have a sense of where God is leading in my life, and now I have to put that into practice. I have to do my part. And so I just want to break this down a little bit for you. What does it mean to do your part? Well, as I said, the first part here, it says, keep reminding them of these things. It's this constant repetition. It's a systematic way in which we go about this. It's a matter of practice. And what are we reminding them of? But it says these things. What are the things? Well, we've been looking now over this book for a couple of weeks now. Those things are of the grace that we find in Jesus. So he says there is forgiveness in him. There is life in him. And not just life when we're dead and now we're in heaven. It says, no, this life begins now. If I If I find myself now giving my life to him, it says it's as if this old man died and God's life now begins in me. But there's a promise of immortality, a promise that extends beyond this brief span that God has given to us. And when you're younger, perhaps many of us, we don't even think twice about it. But let a couple more years get on you, and then all of a sudden you recognize, hey man, this the train is going to be coming to a halt. And then what? And we don't have to worry about that. We've been given an assurance that it says those who die in Christ shall be raised with him, and we shall see him as he is. So if you're going to do your part, then I think what God is asking us to do is, what that means is that you got to share the truth of God's word. That's what he's asking you to do. Remind them of these things. Now, reminding someone is just being that voice that is constantly there. Now, I get it. Like, sometimes people can go overboard and become a nag. I know sometimes some can be overbearing in their zeal for the things of God. Can I give you just like a practical little example of that? You guys know I have 4 sons, right? They're not always the neatest bunch. And so I got kind of tired of telling them to pick up their stuff all the time. So what I did now is I take out my phone and I take a picture of their junk laid all over the place, and I just take a picture and then I text it to them. And if I went around and I saw something else, I just take a picture and just send it to them. It would bug them to, oh man, they hated that. And then I just keep on doing that all the time. Just a gentle reminder. But it was amazing how they just started picking it up. If we don't remind people of this good news about Jesus, then where are they going to hear it? Where in our culture do you see those kinds of conversations just springing up on their own? You know what the problem is? Everybody thinks somebody else is going to do it, and nobody winds up doing it. And it doesn't have to be anything like, you know, hey, look, I just came back from seminary school. It could be just you sharing, reminding them of these things. About what makes you tick, why you do the things that you do. See, the point here is that all you got to do is act as a reminder. You really don't have to try to convince anyone. That's not your job. When you do your part, all you got to do is share God's truth. Last time I read in John chapter 14, it says that the Holy Spirit will convict of sin and righteousness and judgment. It's not my job. I'm not the master guilt manipulator. So doing your part means that I just got to share God's word. Here's another thing. It says, warn them before God against quarreling about words. Well, if I'm going to warn them, and I'm warning them before God, it's because God is going to be the witness to what I'm saying. But notice what the text says here. It says, I want you to warn them in particular about quarreling about words, because people were getting into all kinds of contentious talk, giving their opinions about all kinds of issues of the scripture, and no doubt about their culture. I wrote something down that I want to just be very clear about what I'm going to say on this point, because I think it's a big one. God is asking his people to be pursuing the call of God on their life, to do their part by sharing the word, but by not being contentious. Timothy, like Timothy, the days in which we live are marked by bickering and disputes and discord. We are to give voice to sound teaching as our workers. We just saw, right? Someone tried and true, confident in their efforts. One who, it says, is also not given to being contentious. But perhaps one place to start might be by refraining from offering our opinions as an end to a discussion rather than an opening. Many have observed that Facebook and Twitter and email, the virtual spaces in which we engage others, have removed many of the filters that ordinarily would modify our tone and our content. Far too many sit behind a computer screen and are emboldened to give full voice to their opinions without pausing to consider the impact that it might be having on others, without stopping long enough to notice if we have even engaged the other person. All we do is take out a grenade and throw it on the other side, and tough if you're on the other side. This is how I feel. You know, there are two areas that I think we need to resist the temptation to quarrel about words. One of them is matters of faith. I've been at this now for a long time, since 1979. I can tell you some of the most jacked up conversations I've ever had have been about matters of faith. Things of no consequence. I remember distinctly as a young guy going into a church and being met at the door by a lady who was handing out these little tracts on why the King James Bible is the only true Bible. Really? That's the first thing I'm going to do when people come walking in here. Give them this little tract. Or the arguments that people would get about what the end times are going to be like. Or the worship wars. What's worshipful and what's not. And it's interesting how it's always clothed in the way in which we look at what's worship for me. Or those secondary issues like, you know, can you have a glass of wine or a beer? You heard that joke, right? This guy really likes his pastor, this Baptist preacher, right? And so he invites him along and he says to his friend before the day, he says, look, I'm going to take the preacher fishing, but, you know, I like to be out on the water and I have this little cooler. I got some beers in there. What do you think? He says, oh, I think he's fine. So he goes, pastor drinks all the beer. So he comes back and he tells his friend, he says, yo, what's up with that? I bring the preacher, man. He drank all the beer. He says, I don't know. He probably doesn't get to do it often, so he does it again. And sure enough, the preacher drinks all the beer. So he comes back to his friend, you know, the third time, says, look, what do I do? Man, I like the guy, but he says, oh, I know. It's easy. Just invite another Baptist. It's all right for me to drink the beer when nobody's watching, but bring another person in there and then all of a sudden it's not. What's up with that? If God is our witness, if something's not right, you shouldn't do it whether that guy's there or he's not there. But in areas of Christian liberty, I can't tell you how often the contentiousness over words begins to just swell up like movies or dancing. I got a rule. Dancing is a sin if you dance badly. Well, why are you guys laughing? I see some of you dance. I grew up dancing. If you couldn't dance, you couldn't hang out. What does that have to do with Jesus? Now, I know, see, we could begin to quarrel about this, right? Because it's like, well, where are you dancing? What songs are you dancing to? I mean, I get it. But God has also given us filters, right? He's given us this word of God. If I'm going to be a workman that's not ashamed, then I got to be able to say that I can take Jesus wherever I am. But I don't think that if I'm dancing with my wife or I'm dancing with some friends, that necessarily means that I'm on my way to hell. But there is a contentiousness on matters of faith where people major on the minors instead of majoring on the majors. The major has everything to do with, are you pursuing God's call and are you doing your part? Amen. And politics? Hey, it's awesome that you can express your personal opinions. But does it always have to be with a sense of bitterness and hatred? You realize how sometimes your words could be causing other people to respond in a way that just seems to fan into flame the very divisions that are being felt all around our culture and our society right now. It's horrible. And I think people are just emboldened because they sit behind that screen and they just let it fly. You would never be as bold in person sitting across a chair from somebody as you would be sometimes sitting there on your little phone or on your on the keyboard. So why do we do that? So in matters of faith and politics, things like that, can't you see that when Paul is saying to Timothy here, look, I want you to warn them about quarreling of words. I get the context is one of which where he's talking about people who are putting forth their opinions as if they were God's opinions. In the text, they'll say that some people were already saying that the resurrection happened, which was a nice way of saying that this is just something that's spiritual. It's not anything that is really physical. It's just meant to be for you and I to just think of it like in a spiritual way. No. Jesus was very clear. Your mortal flesh is going to take on immortality. This corruptible is going to take on that which is incorruptible. The temporal is going to be now housed in the eternal. You are going to have a new body. So this idea that, it's just a spiritual resurrection. No, it is a physical resurrection. Jesus rose from the dead and people saw him. And by the way, Jesus also was able to eat meals with people. How did that happen? I have no clue. But the text says that he interacted with them. They saw him. Didn't he tell Thomas, put your finger in the side here of my flesh? So there was something about this new body. It wasn't just some little apparition. But people start quarreling about things of secondary natures, and the next thing you know, fellowships are divided. I'm sure we all have some of those stories that perhaps you can tell about how over secondary issues, friends who used to be friends for a long time, all of a sudden leave. Why is that? Honestly, why is that? Because you like hymns better than choruses? Because you like the King James Version better than the New International Version? When you get to heaven, that really is going to matter. It keeps us from being contentious. Let me give you one more thing here. There's a text. Write this down in your notes. Ephesians 4:29. This is a great text. Jesus said, the Apostle Paul here in the book of Ephesians was writing to tell people, look, the truth that you have learned about in Jesus has caused us to step away from this old life, to be renewed in our minds, and then begin to do this new life that is created after Christ Jesus. And so he begins to give them a bunch of illustrations. And one of those illustrations is this. He says, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths. See that word unwholesome? It's a word that is used to describe fish that has gone bad. Not a very pleasant smell. The unwholesomeness there is the putrid nature of these words that come out of your mouth. He says, don't let any unwholesome words come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs. So the words that come out of my mouth ought to be building someone up, not by my needs, but according to their needs. And then it goes on and says that it may benefit those who listen. If that became a grid by which we as believers would engage people around us, it might transform a whole lot of different kind of conversations. If the words that come out of your mouth are unwholesome, then why are you spreading them? If they're not benefiting anybody except for you, then why are you sharing them? It's meant to build them up, to benefit those who are listening. So you have then the results of all this quarreling. You see in verse 14, it says, it is of no value. It ruins those who listen. The word ruin there is the Greek word catastrophe. It's catastrophic. That's what happens when people listen to this vitriol day in and day out. Aren't you tired of listening to the news? Aren't you tired of getting on Facebook and having all this like just banter going forth? What does it do on inside of you, a steady diet of that? You can see now why, you know, in the circumstances that were surrounding Timothy, because he was living in a very secular kind of environment, it was beginning to wear down on him. Paul says, look, don't get caught up in that. Look at verse 16. Avoid godless chatter. Why? Because those who indulge in it will become more and more ungodly. So I want you to look at verse 14 and 16 real quick. It will ruin those who listen. In verse 16, it says, those who indulge in it will become even more godly. So the person who is speaking and the person who is listening, it's having a detrimental effect on both. So as you do your part, let's do our part without being contentious. But there's something even more, I think, more threatening in the text, and that is, as you look at verse 16, I think it's telling us not to put words in God's mouth. Don't make God say things that he's never said. And why do I say that? Look at these next few verses. It says, avoid godless chatter, because those who indulge in it will become more and more ungodly. Their teaching will spread like gangrene. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, who have wandered away from the truth. They say that the resurrection has already taken place. They destroy the faith of some. See, that word godless, it's a very pictured word where it talks about someone who can't pass the threshold of the temple of God. It is ungodly. It's saying, you and me, we ought to avoid that kind of chatter that has no place before God or his people. Because that kind of chatter, godless chatter, it says what it does is it acts like gangrene. It eats away at the good. People have wandered away from the truth. Why? It's not because they didn't know the truth. It's because they put up a new target. They hit the wrong target. They're destroying the faith of some. It's destructive. Their false teaching is having a detrimental effect on people. Why? Because they're saying things that God never said. God's word is to bring life, not death. If people in their following after God, it's making them into a more sour person, something's wrong with that gospel. The person who really loves Jesus, talk to the people who are around them the most. They ought to know it. If my love for Jesus is so like gangrenous that everybody around me just, I'm making them worse than better. Don't you see that I'm not doing my part? As a people of God, we ought to be the most settled. We have the greatest reasons to rejoice. Even when we mess up, we serve a God who says, 70 times 7, man, just give me your heart. Let's work on this together. The visions that we have of God can't be this condemning judge, but a God who loves us so much that he's not going to leave us the way he found us. And so there's one last thing here. If we're going to, the way to respond to these opposing views in our culture is by first you got to be the right person. I got to pursue God's way, and then I got to be doing the right things in the right way. And then there comes a place where you just have to let God take hold of the outcome. Leave it to him. Notice here in verse 19, nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm, sealed with this inscription. The Lord knows those who are his, and everyone who confesses the name of the Lord must turn away from wickedness. God's foundation is firmly established on the words and the work of Jesus. We get to participate in this building project as we are faithful, not only in our actions, but with our words. And what it's saying is here that God already has established a firm foundation. There's nothing that we can do to add to that. Why? Because the Lord knows those who are His. Read that. The Lord knows that those who are His. What is that saying? That's saying that God sees what we cannot. God sees the heart. I always kid around with people sometimes when they think like, well, that person will never get into heaven. Wouldn't you be surprised when you get there and all of a sudden they meet you at the gate? And not only that, but they meet you and they go, what are you doing here? See, God sees what we cannot. God knows those who are His. It's not our job to go out there and start making these proclamations about who's in and who's out. You don't know. The thief on the cross, everybody would have counted him out. But in that last moment in his life, Jesus says, today you will be with me in paradise. Everybody's got a chance. Because it's not about how good you are, it's about how good Jesus is. But nobody's coming except through Jesus. So that we can remind them of all the time. Lord knows those who are His. All you got to do is keep reminding them of the good things of Jesus and let Him do His work. But you know what you can do? Notice what it says here. Everyone who confesses the name of Jesus must turn away from wickedness. In other words, you can't ignore what can be seen. And what can be seen is our fruit. That's why, I don't know if you caught this, but the way in which you are going to respond to the opposing views that we find in our culture, according to 2 Timothy, it begins just with being the right person and giving yourself to doing the right things. That's the best argument that you can give. Is to keep your eyes on Jesus and to begin to live out what it is that He's causing us or calling us to do. Because Timothy right now is in this prison and God is asking him to break, Paul is asking him to break out of this self-imposed prison. A prison, as we see in the text, of the challenge of opposing views. He's getting so many voices around him, it has placed him in a position of paralysis. And so Paul speaks into his life saying, look, pursue his call. Do your part and leave the rest to me. Be a faithful worker. Tried and true. Confident. And one who correctly handles the word of God. So as we close, what are your study habits? We started this big idea. We have over 800 people that are now on this site. It's just a quick little thing. We give out a text for you to think about before Sunday and a little commentary afterwards and then a story. Three times a week to just help us to stay in this word. Some of you are more mature maybe, or you have different methodologies that you're using. That's fine, but do something. We just created this big idea so that we could keep the congregation together in the Word. But do something, because God is asking you to fulfill this call in your life. Do your part. And you'll begin to see how that begins to influence your relationships and friendships. How God will use you in a way that sometimes will just absolutely surprise you. Amen? Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you for this gift that you have given us in this word. It keeps us centered. It helps us to major on the majors, to give us the big picture of Jesus, so that, Lord, we in our own life, Lord, may not become so critical of ourselves and of others, that we would give ourselves to doing the good, letting this light that you've placed in us shine so people see our good work and glorify you, our Father in heaven. I want to thank you, Lord, for a Spirit of God that's in us that is relentless, constantly prompting us, Lord, to be the kind of people that you've called us to be. Just give us ears to hear and eyes to see. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.